to read their bios because they are extensive, but I'm just going to briefly now introduce them. Lydia Polgreen is deputy national editor of the New York Times, which is a major step in anyone's life, and it gives her a say in all international issues, including South Africa, for which she is uniquely qualified, having served as the Times bureau chief in South Africa from 2005 to 2009, which is the reverse event. And as much as I have my own sources and perspectives, I always check with Lydia or read her stories to make sure I hadn't missed something. And when I had, she was ever gracious in sharing what she knew, which was a lie. John Stremlau has a loving wife, Carolyn, who is here with him today, but she has some competition in John's love affair with South Africa, possibly predating his resident years from 1998 to 2006 as the head of the International Relations Department at the University of, as the director of the Center for African Relations, International Relations at the University of the Witwatersrand in Johannesburg. We often have email exchanges about South Africa and in person. When the Carter Center Board, on which I serve, meets and we help members over the center's programs on a range of things, global, regional, and all of which are laid out in the program. And finally, a man I refer to as my Utiwami, which is for my brother, whom I met through his amazing, timeless novel, Ways of Dying, whose protagonist spirits what passes for a living as a professional mourner. It is one of the most insightful books I have ever read about people who are usually portrayed in ways that are unrecognizable to themselves. It's a little tiny book, but it is so full that I encourage all of you to read it, although he's got 20 other novels you can also read, among many other wonderful literary and cultural endeavors. He comes to us today from Ohio University, where he is professor of creative writing. And Zakes, I'm going to stop you, and I want you to tell us where you were on that day in 1994, when South Africans lined up in long queues that in the early morning hours before the voting to do what they had never been able to do in their lives. My Mandela was in his 70s at the time. It was the first time that any of them experiences that day, and your expectations for your almost redundancy.
Well, I was here. Yes, that is the best. Well, they used to have the Southern African research program here. And I think the story called but on the specific day, voting day, I took a train to Montreal, in Canada, which is where I voted, and then train accepted. And that was the very first time that I voted.
You were how old?
To contemplate. But I'm definitely in my 40s, maybe. Because I'm in my mid 60s now, just 20 years ago. So, yes. And of course, I was very excited. Yes. What were my expectations of the new democracy? One thing I was mostly excited about was what I hoped to be a new culture of human rights that was going to be introduced. As a writer in apartheid in South Africa, I feel my books being. Government. So, it was a
most liberal constitutions in the world, one of the first to include gay marriage or protection of adopted children and so on. So I think your point is very well taken. It had a fundamental code that it established for human rights and freedom of expression. John, you didn't get to South Africa until 1996, but surely in 1994, being the esteemed professor you are, you had your eye on South Africa.
Sure.
I did surely know from Washington that I was looking for the Carnegie Commission on Deadly Conflict, so that I felt a sense of great relief when South Africans went to the polls. We knew Bosnia was burning. We had the genocide in Rwanda the same month in 1994. And thank God we had this one in South Africa. So,
you got hope.
Well, there we go.
Yes, you can. You sort of spread it for the phrase as you speak.
But I felt relief at a different level. I, too, felt that South Africa, and many of my colleagues did, was going to burn. And then it was during the 60s and 70s, and I said, this is going to be a catastrophe. And I'd never been to South Africa, wanted to go there. And it was Bill Foulkes in the same program that Zakes just mentioned. So I want all you good folks in New Haven to know how much we appreciate all you being here today, but also what your connections to South Africa meant. Building those first bridges, because Bill said, you've got to get down there, and I'll take you down there in 1978. And it was the dark days, but it was open enough that I could get down there and see, and then come back. So I felt great relief that race work was avoided. But the final point I want to make was the kind of reverence I felt to that moment. Because anyone who knew the history and what the Rhodesia trial was all about 20 years earlier, 30 years earlier, 1964, when Mississippi air was burning, by the way, in the United States, Mandela said then that you had to have inclusive democracy. And so he delivered in 1994 that inclusive democracy. And although he gave 3 hours of talks to the doc, there was one sentence that I think would summarize everything he was about in South Africa's problem. He said the foundation first lies in the consent of the people. First lies the consent of the people. Now, you good folks in Connecticut know that wasn't invented in South Africa. That's Thomas Slipper talking in 1638 here in Hartford, Connecticut. Here before you guys found this local town, they weren't very inclusive then. South Africa's a lot more inclusive today.
We'll get to today in a minute. And I know you can hardly wait. But we're going to wait another minute while Lydia, tell us where you were in 1994. Let's all be a little bit ashamed that we're so old.
In 1994, I was when the voting was happening in April of 1994, I was coming to the end of my first year of college in Maryland. And, I had a slightly different perspective on the events in South Africa because I'd actually spent most of my childhood in Africa. My mother is from Ethiopia. I lived in Kenya when I was a small child, when there was the first coup attempt in 1982, I remember. Blood in the streets then. We had schoolmates when I lived in Ghana in high school fleeing the Civil War in Liberia. So I had a pretty good idea of what the risks were for a country like South Africa in not having a peaceful transition. That what we were seeing in 1994 was a remarkable departure from what had been the history of really strife-filled transitions. And like many people and many young people who came to their political consciousness watching the anti-apartheid movement, that moment was extremely formative for me. And knowing that there was another path, there was another way for Africans to choose their future and their destiny, I think it was a big part of why I became a journalist and why continue to cover the stories that I cover. And, of course, hope doesn't last in the way that you think it's going to. But it's hard not to look back on those early days and feel the incredible elation that we all felt watching our
whole country, the whole people. As you said, you indicated that many people were expecting a bloodbath because they did not expect the white apartheid regime to give up so easily. And yet, that didn't happen. So, how do you see Mandela's role at the time, but also let's now move it a little bit forward, his impact on the evolving young democracy?
Well, Mandela is the example as far as us go. He's for the ages of Mandela's role. Does inspire us. He has a mind in quality. That stubbornness of fairness, belief that the rule must prevail, led this man to 27 years in jail to come out fed. As he said he would in the Rivonia trial.
In 1964.
Yes, he said in 64 that he would die for the principle of democracy. And democracy means that no man is above the law. And so when the court case was being made about discrimination in the rugby, and his aides all said, "You can't, you're sitting president, you can't go into court." He said, "I'm no man's above the law, I will go and I will give testimony," and he did. And well, we really need to press on the born freeze, that's what the kids coming to like this university.
At one, after Mandela
born, after apartheid, so they didn't know it firsthand. Just like too many of people today.
Point that way.
Are being reminded today of what the struggle took us 220 years to get to, you know, stop that was bad 20 years. 120 years from now, they've got everybody to know.
Zakes, I've read almost everything you've written, although you only read one book. But you wrote a very interesting piece at Mandela Transition last year, and you described Mandela as a contradictions. How do you see his role at the beginning of South Africa's democracy and his impact as that democracy evolved?
Well, the contradictions I was talking about, you know, the Mandela of the 19th. He was imprisoned. I've got to know him because my father was a founding member of the SPC and was the president of the SPC. And people like Mandela also served in his executive general secretary.
Put your father's name in the record. This is being recorded. Your father's name was, come on.
So, Mandela then, you know, what I mean, his title, I mean, for some years as well, I was talking mostly about the contradictions. As a young woman, I mean, as a young man, very patient. Sometimes I do tell you something easy. And he had no patience with any opposition. You know, heckle people, close down meetings. He and my father and the others in the schools. So, I looked at that evolution in him, you know, into the Mandela. But I was also looking at him as an African aristocrat. You know, he is from a chiefly family an institution which is known for its conservatism in Eastern countries. And he himself, actually, is in many respects a all of those issues. Well, I mean, they lose. You see, but they push through despite the fact that the majority is not for the people. You know, so they did get through leaders who did not
go for polls and say, what do the people think on these issues? Okay, let's follow the people.
But they educated the people, they led the people, you know, and took this progressive route, whereby they introduced, you know, anything this new constitution. And that's what it is. By the way, these issues, the Bill of Rights was
given. You know,
even though the constitution was negotiated by different parties, the ruling party
on the time, national party, and so on,
it was actually put through by parties, especially these issues. Another mention
of sexual orientation,
another challenge of the parties, which is that particular committee that drew that against opposition of the other parties, which was in line with the majority of the people. So, those are the predictions that
he was able to map out a very progressive power,
despite the fact that the majority
of his people
are still very conservative on those specific issues.
That's right. We can talk about some of those in a little while, because I've written about some of them, especially this whole issue of corrective rape, where there have been rape lesbian women to cure them of being gay. At the same time, we have this great constitution that guarantees their rights, but come back to that a little bit. We'll come back to that in a bit. John, there were those who say that Mandela gave up too much in order to avoid that bloodbath that everybody, many people thought was coming. And so that today, one of the major problems of South Africa is inequality in this country. A very few black people have managed to get the middle class and maybe even the upper middle class, but that the country, by and large, particularly the economy, which is one of the most critical variables in the whole democratic equation, is still very much controlled by, in the hands of whites, and the blacks continue to suffer lower class status and lack of entry into the economy. God, that was too long a question.
It's a good question. We all know the ANC is talking about the second phase of reform, which is largely economic and
unemployment and inequality and poverty. It's a toxic combination that is affecting most South Africans. But a couple things about Mandela and the compromise. Cornel West described Mandela as a jazz man of freedom struggle. I think that's apt because he had to improvise all along the way. Did not do it alone. And what is really interesting to me is the role the party plays. I think the bargain at the core of the deal in 94 was so the whites kept the keys to the economy, the blacks were given the keys to the political kingdom. And the party remained predominant, not one man. So Mandela was always a party man, and Becky was forced to step down, and Zuma is only an ANC card. There's an analysis on it this week to the parliament just a couple of weeks ago on the State of the Nation, and it was clearly a party. So can the party bring along the kind of equity that's necessary to sustain development? That's what we're all debating. It's a big subject, certainly. I'm reluctant to be brief about the complexities of that.
But you will be.
And to say, Charlayne, that by the way, that the inequities in America, the inequities that come in Connecticut, Connecticut's constitutional state, it's got the second highest inequities in the United States. $13,000 in Hartford and $85,000 in Kings.
Yeah, but we're not going to talk about Connecticut today.
Well, you know,
because when you do look at many of the problems that South Africa is facing, including the inequality, including the lack of education of the vast majority of its students, you see some of the same things here in America. But we're not going to do that for today. To stay with South Africa for the moment. And so let me just go to you, Lydia. You did come as the new democracy was taking a little stronger steps than baby steps. They weren't quite adolescent steps. What things did you see that had worked? And what things did you see that really needed more fine-tuning and more leadership, as it were?
Well, I mean, I think that, you know, when I arrived in South Africa, it was clear that, you know, democracy in all of its forms had taken firm roots in the country at every level. And I'm not just talking about voting. I mean, there are people who have a powerful sense that, you know, people all over the townships in, you know,
the rural areas,
South Africans know that their country belongs to them and that they have the power to change the course that they're on. But I think that, one of the very first things that I covered when I arrived in South Africa was the killing of the 33 miners at Marikana. Mm-hmm. And
the killing of the 33 miners. Everybody knows about
that. There was a wildcat strike happening at a platinum mine outside of Johannesburg. And there had been a bunch of violence in the street. These strikes are often violent affairs because there were rival unions involved. Eventually, the government of South Africa decided to send in the police, and they went in guns blazing, and they killed, 33 miners, which was, I think, really a signal moment for the new democracy. I mean, one of the top leaders of the ANC, Stremlau, who was the head of the mine workers union, and central to the struggle against apartheid, and a central figure in the drawing of the Constitution, who was subsequently later found that he'd been deeply involved as a senior member of the party in the negotiations over whether to use force against these striking miners. So I think that the takeaway from Marikana, and by the way, the Marikana strike is actually on the first page of Thomas Piketty's book, Capital, which is all about inequality. So I think the fact that it's resonated as far as that shows just how deep this question of who gets to share in the wealth of South Africa is really the biggest question that the country faces right now. Because the inequality has actually increased since the end of apartheid. And the greatest inequality is actually not between black and white, but between blacks. So I think you're seeing a situation where class and inequality are outstripping race as the fundamental divide in the country.
I was going to ask you about this, James, because one of the things that the Mandela and Mickey years brought in was, and started with Black economic empowerment, BEE. Americans would know that as affirmative action. And, you know, it is the case that it did empower a certain number of black people, but whites are opposed to it, and blacks are now upset because only a few blacks have made it into the upper reaches of the economy. How do you see this effort to address inequality or of racist discrimination
in the generations? Well, the Mandela term, but I just took root during our meetings. Inequalities that you are talking about. Giving certain advantages to the so-called previously disadvantaged people. But what is happening is that it has indeed created a lot of wealth for quite a few people. Many of whom overnight
talking about.
Don't let me go to yes. But what is the best fit? The people who are empowered by this behavior were by and large members of the Republican, the leaders, members of this family. In other words, people who have very close. So, this new distribution of wealth continues because, as you have heard already, we have now this new class of the super rich blacks. And of course, other middle class blacks who also have benefited from continued years of the class here
and benefited.
And then we have the vast majority of the black people who have not reaped any benefits
from this economic.
So those are the main problems that are facing South Africa today, whereby we see the action of various civil society organizations, new political parties emerging.
John, let me ask you, because one of the things that you do see, and maybe and I'm going to talk to Lydia a few minutes about media coverage and whether that skews our impressions of the country, but John, you do see stories about and without getting there, rolling past actions people like those that Zakes is talking about are demonstrating for basic services which have been they were led to expect when they got into democracy. They would get clean water and indoor toilets and all the sort of basic things. I mean, these people aren't demonstrating for money at the top. They're demonstrating for everyday things that we're all so accustomed to. What do you think explains that dichotomy?
I think the phrase of demonstrations, there was a reference to books on that in papers recently, in the capital country of demonstrations. Still, freedom of expression that is protected by the laws allow these protests to take effect. And the question then becomes, will the government be capable of responding to broaden the middle class? And is that capability constrained by a lack of desire, lack of resolve, or lack of capacity? Basically, my wife, she works in the field of education. I spend a lot of my 20% budget on education. Education is the key to coming to the terms. Education system is still underperforming terribly
in South Africa.
In South Africa, in Washington, D.C. In South Africa.
Well, I was on the
subject. So, you know, we have to come to terms with whether it's a lack of resolve, a lack of capacity. I do see, so long as they protect the Constitution and so long as there is a willingness to continue the struggle, the investments in infrastructure are going up again in this budget. $150 billion last year. The government, I think, in elements of it, want to do more. There is greed and self-dealing, no question, but so long as you have continues to rank high on that. Not so much on police and security, but that's another topic for you.
Good news, bad news. Okay, well, I'm going to do a John Stremlau thing here now to be positive for a moment, because when I first came to South Africa to work full time in 1997, everything, everybody lived in a shack. And today, there are housing, there's better housing for many people. There is access to clean water and so forth. But yet, I had friends in this committee was led by Winnie Mandela, who traveled the country in the last 3 or 4 years. And people are still, there are more people who don't have those kinds of amenities than do. And so what you said, so John says, is it a matter of will or is it just a matter of an enormous problem that has brought over the generations of so much anti-black and anti-human rights?
Well, I think there
that's like that, that believes, well, we're Democrats and we think the government should do everything, or we're Republicans and we think that the government should do nothing. You know, there's a very wide ideological spectrum within the AMC. So, I think there are those who represent parts of the party and parts of the leadership of the country who think that terrible mistakes were made in not spending more money and, raising more money from business in order to build more houses, build out the education system, things like that. But I think that that's absolutely right, that, there's some very big places where a lot of money has been spent, and this has been really wasted in an ineffective way, to really be basically at the same level of education performance in South Africa as you do in Uganda, but they spend 20 times more than Uganda does to get the same lousy results.
And the thing that worries me a lot is that even though universities like University of West Virginia all the universities opened up to black students as never before at the end of apartheid, and yet many of them were so poorly prepared, and even today they can't reach graduation. How worried are you about this, the war freeze, this younger generation? The majority of whom, as I understand it, are not being educated for a modern industrial society as here. But let's keep it on South Africa for the moment.
The education challenge is obviously the devil's all of our countries, but particularly South Africa, given the legacy that's fighting over to South Africa. I guess I come back. Gives redress to the failure to deliver on the promises that were kept. We did get into the political domain of proportional representation rather than constituencies having direct claim to their elected leaders deliver on these services, which is, is a challenge to try to think about how you get more accountability so that people know when they're being screwed. They know when they're being. This thing says that money goes back to Treasury, and a lot of countries it just disappears. Goes your spouse, the investment banker, can tell us a little bit about that.
Some of it does.
Well, you know, greed and fear is all the love and hope to offer. But seriously, the possibility of having improvements in this is real so long as people are prepared to continue this. So long as that struggle is protected as a right. And in the Constitution, there is a right to education. People know that.
But it's not happening.
If the government screws around and takes the Constitution, then wrong.
Yeah, but it's not happening even with this Constitution. Now, Jacob Zuma has said that the African National Congress will rule for Jesus Christ. And recently, in the latest election this year, there was an attempt to form an alliance between Mandela Rampela, who is a progressive struggle, and the Democratic Alliance, which is a predominantly white party, but is trying to bring in more black people to its membership. But that exploded within a week. So where is the hope? I mean, every country needs competition, don't they? And so where is the competition to get leadership to be accountable? If that's part of the problem. Gen 6?
Oh.
Oh, yeah. This is what John started.
We need a strong opposition.
Nation divided among so many fault lines today. We talked about inequality, which is a major fault line, a little bit on education, health. Now, I sort of associate health and leadership because remember, Thabo Mbeki's reign was very progressive in so many ways. The economy grew, there was visionary leadership. And the African Renaissance, which became the watchword for the continent, including many of my articles. But
so that will be his legacy, I'm afraid, for the rest of eternity. But today, the health minister has had major strides in the fight against HIV and AIDS. So is one of the front lines still health, or are they making progress in that area?
Internal, the rest of the world is not telling South Africa how to do it. They listened, but they weren't told. And they, in the case of the backing of HIV/AIDS, I think pride of wanting to do this itself, not beholden to the international community with the retrovirus, which is going to be an independent Sam World Bank and IMF, was this fierce cry. And some people would do it ourselves. And he went down the wrong path. It was a terrible, terrible crime. But he went down the wrong path because of that blindness. This desire to keep South Africa independent, I think, maybe overstating it, but not by much. And the reality of the science caught up with the fact that they can do it their own way. They've done it their own way, and they will continue doing it their own way. America, it starts me to criticize someone when they want to do it their own way, but this is a very serious problem that was neglected, and a lot of people died who didn't have to die.
But that's one of the, I think that's one of the positives where the country is now, because this new health has been very aggressive in treating HIV and AIDS, making ARVs available to people. And yet I'm told now, I don't know, Lydia, if you looked at this before you left the country, that in the rural areas it's difficult to access. How do you see it?
Yeah, I think that South Africa makes, from the Constitution on down, South Africa makes enormous promises to really struggles to deliver. There's no question that enormous strides have been made in getting people access to treatment for HIV and AIDS. One of the benefits of the rollout of ARVs has been that I think overall people are getting better health care because they're in greater contact with their doctors and things are so. So I think that they're
a male-dominated society in so many ways. Where is South Africa now in terms of gender
equality? Women in the cabinet, in parliament, and so on. There are many women issues on the ground.
Like what?
The violation of women in John's bed, because he's in the context where they are wearing mini skirts and so on. Like the issue, the issue that you mentioned, you know, the so called corrective in a big way, because was at least some part of this new constitutional protection.
Go to the audience in a couple of minutes, but let me go to you, John, on this, or anybody who wants to answer it. There's really one of the civil society newsletters that they put out that talked about race in South Africa and how, in spite of all that Nelson Mandela did towards reconciliation and so forth, race is still a ticking time bomb in the country. Anybody want to talk about that?
As a white permanent resident in South Africa, diversity in the African community is grossly underestimated by those of us who think in black and white terms. And it's the struggle of apartheid, which maybe transcended the kind of tribal divisions that a complex country like Nigeria has been dealt with, or Jeff Kellum's article in today's New York Times about Kenya. The good news is, the paradoxical good news is that apartheid brought everybody together, but behind that, seven separate languages that recognize the Constitution. President who's got multiple wives. Xhosa tradition, which is different than the Fulu, and you can go down the list across that whole gamut. These are the oldest people on the planet. They have evolved into very complex social and sub-ethnic groups, and bringing them, melding them to one alike is the great challenge of that Constitution, which is very different than a young country like this country, America. The Indian owners of the casinos here 15,000 years in this country, whereas they've been 300,000 years 3 million years in the noise of Southern Africa. So think about that complexity when you're trying to say, let's get consensus born of this diversity. It's a much bigger challenge on the global planet.
Thanks. You take on the is it a ticking time bomb? Is something still likely to explode racially, or?
Well, I mean, you know, I'm afraid to say, you know, this whole conversation, especially in business cases, is different because you correctly put it as what you said, the biggest disparity is between those.
The super rich blacks were very conspicuous consumers.
Yes, yes. Very much because the parties, the weddings, are they show. Now, the problem is, when people talk, including some of the more recent political parties, but they mentioned it, have taken the youth by storm, they blame whites. This for this. It's always the black and white kind of thing. One needs to hear more of it. Even in Parliament, in the debates, they say, that's why black people have problems and so on.
Yeah, I would say that there is a school of thought, and it's been popularized by certain political leaders on the far left and in the that the biggest beneficiaries at the end of apartheid are actually white people. They got to keep the keys that mechanized the economy, and they shed the terrible constraints and the guilt and the moral weight of this horrible system. So I think there is a school of thought that this is actually a very long con. There are these poor masses who say, wait a minute, who's really in charge here?
I have some concluding questions, but before we get to those, I would and a piece, John. But before we get to those, I'll let it go to the audience for a few minutes. And who do we have? I think we have some microphones set up. From the audience who would like to ask some questions, please get up, raise your hand, and just make it over to the microphone. And while you're doing that, then I'll ask another question, and then we get two or three people on each side. Corruption. I read something the other day where one of the ANC letters statements: corruption is a cancer and has no place in our society. That came from the ANC. And yet, every time you turn around, from the president on down, somebody's being accused of corruption. What is this, at this point, in this young democracy, more? Is this extraordinary, John?
Media, you've got very strong media so far. You have open press. That helps. At least you know where the dirt is.
But does that mean that there's more of it, or just better coverage of it? Takes.
Because, our press, as you know, is quite robust. And they are always digging out and discovering things. But also, the very same people you're quoting here, corruption, we are going to put it out, and it is bad. That's some of the most corrupt people.
take it just a little bit away. Yeah, thanks.
Yeah, my name is Manny. Before I even ask my question, I just want to say yes to things that you guys have said. So I was wondering, considering the name of your group of stuff, I was wondering what kind of role Park played in the change from apartheid to the.
Oh, that's great, because that was one of the questions I did get to and wanted to ask, especially Zakes, who is in and out of the country all the time, one of his great cultural icons, really. How has cultural life progressed since the end of apartheid?
In all fields of art. In theater, for instance, there was a time immediately after 1994 when there was a lull in activities. The changes that came took most of us by surprise. We were prepared for a protracted struggle. And then, you know, these people came in and changed. So, it took us a couple of years to recover. But there's a lot of activity that is happening in all aspects of the world. In creative writing, for instance, we have more novels being published, in the last 5 years, more novels published than in the whole history of society. Only in the past 5 years. So you can see that. And it is the same in other arts areas, with some of the best companies touring in America all the time. I was watching one in North Carolina last week at American. So there's a lot of artistic activity. And some of which, of course, you can imagine with that kind of mass novels, for instance. Some of it would be mediocre, but some of it, of course, will be great.
Yeah. I think I read that many of the South African writers today are going away from the past and apartheid and discrimination and oppression to just pursue cultural life, the themes of life, not just the apartheid and the rest of that. But anyway, you can talk about it later. Let me move to this gentleman.
My name is Lee.
But at any point, I won't go into that. But you mean the younger generation that you just alluded to. And I think we talked about that a little bit, that they're now moving away from some of the themes of oppression of the past and just writing about life.
Well, but I think there's also, the same strengths that you're seeing. I agree from the John that these are signs of the health of South Africa's democracy. It's that, much of the kind of social expression that you're seeing among young artists, I'm thinking of people like Sipiwe Dana, who's a South African singer, is dealing and grappling with the issues of contemporary South Africa in a very, whether it's, plays about the issues of corrective rape and sexual violence against women, music that, these are all works of art that really explore the sort of the joys, but also the great So I think it's hard to say whether the glass is half full or half empty in the eyes of young artists in South Africa. But I think that, you know, like all artists do, they're looking at their country with a critical eye and saying, you know, we love South Africa, but we see real problems.
But they're not leaving.
In fact, I mean, one thing that I wanted to tell you, one thing that's remarkable is actually that a lot of the white South Africans who left are coming back in part because they can't have winter. They just can't deal with the weather.
Right. Yeah, John, you're a big collector of South African art and a sponsor of some programs here. Do you see a change in the things and things that the
associated
with you? You see a new generation coming along that are being nurtured. Some of the galleries are cultivating that, being the special effort. Here in paper in Johannesburg, Mary Sabande's work in photography, a young woman is really very compelling in her trying to understand the cross currents that define country. But I have been so taken by the cross fertilization between American art and music and South African art music. And some of that's Abraham being a student of Gallatin and then coming back, and he's located there, but they're nurturing younger artists to come where the possibilities now are so much greater, because South Africa is, as Ali Wasby said, the second greatest, second global nation after the United States.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Hi, my name is Alexander Petronis.
Can you get a little bit closer?
My name is Alexander Petronis, and my question regards the frequent mentioning continue the struggle in South Africa. So, this particular targets who will take the leadership, in the sense that in the past the ANC had taken that leadership role, but considering its tendency to side with transnational corporations, as we see the Americana massacre, and the more neoliberal policies that it's shown itself to even push for, where does the leadership for continuing the struggle lie in South Africa, and what form does it take? It could take a very top-down form or a very bottom-up form, like we see with the ACMU.
I think it's a fabulous question, because I don't really see much nurturing of a successor in leadership, John.
I'm surprised that we're at a quarter past four. I don't expect to do this at level.
Yes!
The young radical.
Which is probably a good thing.
You and I would agree that the tendency of the risk of populism or mass swing, I don't see, as long as the party keeps some discipline, where are the younger leaders coming from? That is, you know, a major question. One of the reasons I want to get back is because some of the nurturing of some of the leaderships at the universities becomes the cutters that could then build. But so far, they've been sliced off by Julius Malema to some extent.
And those of you who don't know, Julius Malema is a young firebrand who is touting the notion of nationalism. Nationalism remains in times and it's helping. But he's had his own issues with corruption. So I think that, you know, what he does, you see, this is where the education issue comes in. Because if you look at those who he appealed to in the recent election, it was these young people who don't see any future for themselves at the moment, who are not at school, who are not being educated, and who are listening to him say, they owe us the following. And so if you don't have any counter to that, then is it possible that a young Malema, like,
did I say crazy?
No, I didn't say that. A young firebrand, and I'll use that term, could really gain some credence in the country among these young born freaks.
Unemployed.
This is the majority, which is the majority of those people who get paid on a great problem. You see, where you look at the board fees, so-called board fees, you'll find
many of the black unemployed from the top cities of the rural area and so on see Mandela, you know, as just as their salvation. Why? Because he's talking of taking funds from white people and redistributing them. Mm-hmm. So that is here, I think, who doesn't want that? So, they are not populism, and they follow him in great numbers.
I think you also have to remember that the history of the ANC was one of, like, deep left-wing politics, right? I mean, now we think of the ANC as being this kind of, you know, center-left party, but one of the biggest debates was, you know, was Mandela ever a member of the Communist Party? And there's been some, you know, back and forth about that. But they were very much on the kind of left side of the Cold War divide. And I think that there is a whole, kind of, there's an enormous amount of political space in South Africa that's far to the left of the ANC that's essentially unoccupied at this point. And so, you know, Malema is a figure who is taking both, you know, kind of nationalist rhetoric that is maybe traditionally thought of as being a little bit more right-wing, along with, you know, some, like, hardcore left-wing things about, you know, nationalization and others. Stirring it up into a very potent stew. I mean, one thing that I think would be really interesting is if you started to see a workers' party emerge out of a split in Kasatu, which is really one
starting.
Yeah, there's one starting. Will it get anywhere? I don't know. But I think that you know, it's that to me is the beginning of the end of the ANC as a mass movement. If you start to see it,
that could go on for a while.
Once we get deep into the acronyms, and, you know, we're in trouble.
but I just want to say, I'm not cutting you off.
So please, no.
I just want to get these last audience members and then have a little brief summary. Yes, sir.
My name is Bob Gilbeck. I am interested in some comparisons I heard this afternoon. Difficulty in trying to make comparisons between cultures and societies. Nonetheless, South Africa was a relatively late colony and produced rather extreme kind of discrimination and oppression against the local population. There is another part of the world that has had a similar kind of experience, one which I imagine Mr. Stremlau's organization will probably be looking closely at in the next few years, if they haven't already, and that's in the Middle East. Back in 2009, a commission that was actually organized and paid for by the South African government as part of its concern about the end of apartheid and the end of its own involvement in apartheid, asked this commission to investigate whether there was, in fact, apartheid in policy and operations in the treatment of the Palestinian areas by the State of Israel.
And that,
my question is, they came to the conclusion that there was. I'm inclined to agree with it, but the question I want to ask to the panel is, to the extent that we can learn anything, that we can apply any lessons from the end of apartheid in South Africa, how would it apply to consider, how would those lessons apply to the kind of problems that we see currently in the Middle East?
John, I have a quick answer. When I was in South Africa with James Baker and Dennis Ross in 1990, Ross, as you know, worked in the Middle East for many years, turned and said, if I had Nationalist Party, the ANC people, the center would hold. We don't have the center holding in places that are so polarized that you can't print. The word on the letter, which we didn't mention, is now a member of parliament. He's got 25 seats in the parliament. He's being co-opted, thank God, maybe. So the genius of South Africa is this inclusivity.
Yes.
Hi, my name is Melinda Tubus. I have a kind of what-if question, and some of this most recent conversation is sort of in part of my thinking on this. I was involved in the anti-apartheid movement in the 70s and early 80s, and I finally got there in 2004, before that election, 2004 election. And it just seemed like there was so much poverty among black South Africans, and the expectations were so high. that was just all put to the side in this great compromise that would allow this election to happen and allow us to take, become, you know, majority, and so that the economic problems just kind of didn't get addressed as much as some of these other things that did get dealt with. Is that sort of?
So, so you're not sure what your question.
Well, my question is just that when the expectations were so high that something would change, and things couldn't change for all those people so quickly, and then there was, you know, discontent and so on. Was there ever a possibility, I guess, if you, from all of your experience, do you think there was a possibility of doing it a different way, that there could have been more equality in that changeover to black majority rule, that there wouldn't end up being such a big economic disparity? Like you were saying, the biggest difference now is not between black and white, but between black and black, economically speaking.
And let me just say, because I think somebody tell me how much time we have, because I lost track. How much time do we have? We have 7 minutes.
I guess I would tailor that question to say, and I'll get to you as our last question, but using that question to ask, are our expectations of a democracy that's only 20 years old too great? And if you answer that question, are there things with that really do stand out as things you really got to watch? In other words, are we expecting too much in a young democracy? And if not, given the problems that you've all talked about, how do you address this? I guess to get it from going from its baby steps or its adolescent steps to its grown-up steps. Is that kind of where you want to go with that?
I think I have a very hopeful view on that, which is that, you know, the emergence of political figures like Julius Malema, as sort of scary as he might seem, is actually a really positive sign that the political space is opening up, and that a long overdue ideological debate about what should be the structure of the economy. You know, these conversations are happening now, and I think they're happening perhaps not with the most important players yet, but the ferment that we're seeing now, knowing that there is this undergirding safety of the Constitution, can only bring good things to South Africa in the future.
If the two of you agree, I'll go to the next question.
You don't have to do it.
Disagree with me.
You agree?
You agree?
Okay, because I'm going to go to the next question.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Final question from the audience.
I wanted to ask about daily life in South Africa. I was interested at the National Museum of African Art, and we hosted an artist who brought his work and talked about it, and he said, who are seeking to come to the city, and they said, tear down the status of living, cannot find them. And he said, they called this campaign Lights Out. And then they started to call it the Blackout. And then they started to call it Lights Out. I just wonder, is it that blatant?
Who know better.
Thanks.
I find that very strange. I mean, to be sure, well, John, go ahead. I can come in later.
I thought we've got very little time left for Elaine and the S-Con problems. I'm not going to get into obviously.
No, but I thought you thought about something else.
And the notion of security and fear, which is real, has to be addressed. It's part and parcel of a society that's taken job with inequalities that we've been describing for the last couple of years.
Do you have a comment on that?
Well, just that I think that there is enormous problems with crime and with and fear about others. Let's not forget that, you know, just talking about services, jobs, led to terrible killings of complete Africans from other countries, Nigerians, Zimbabweans. Sometimes I think that South Africans can forget, believe a little bit too much of their own positive press and forget that, they should set an example.
In 2 minutes, then 30 seconds, and then I've got a question for number three. How do you think the media, generally, our international media, covers South Africa? Is it giving Americans and other, particularly Americans, it's that we are in, mostly, a fair picture?
No, aside from your own. Besides my own highly nuanced and very balanced. here's my 30 seconds on the news. I would say we do a pretty bad job because I think we go between extremes. We have two tropes about South Africa. One is, the miracle, the rainbow nation, what a wonderful, wonderful place. Look at how everybody loves each other, racial harmony, the end. And the other extreme is, Oscar Pistorius trial, crime, you're focusing on the most sort of ragged and savage examples of the shortcomings of South Africa, when of course there's a whole range of experiences between those two poles that is a reflects an accurate picture. And so I think that, it's a mixed bag.
I wrote about the mysterious judge, and I
that was a great piece of mine. Thank you.
I don't know if you might say that.
But I just think that was the window into that case that
we need to know about because there's history there and current history. Anyway, my final question, though, is a question that John is eager to answer. And that is, how, if at all, does what happens in South Africa matter to America and then the other two? Take a crack at that. I know John is itching to answer that question.
The segue into that is to say, please go to South Africa, don't just rely on the media. That's what Bill Foltz told me. If you've been there, get yourself down there and see South Africa for yourself. The second reason, which is to answer Charlayne's question, I think, we are about the debate in this world of ours whether authoritarian centralism in China works better than liberal democracy. We in the West think we have a formula that works. South Africa is not in the West. South Africa is a decidedly southern third world country that wants to believe in a global approach, but it's also a liberal democracy. How deep does this democracy go? I will end with one anecdote. Remember when Bishop Tutu was retiring as the Archbishop of an Anglican church? Mandela put the decoration around his neck in the cathedral in 96. South Africa. Tutu got up, said a few words, and then looked and spoke in Afrikaans, which I cannot understand. The clerk was in the front row, and he said something to the clerk that brought tears on this poor boy's face, running down his face, down his cheek. I said, if this country can come this far in bridging those gaps, when we have been in the business for 220 years, and we still are screwing around,
give
South Africa.
I would say that, you live in a country here in the United States where we are so deeply cynical. We're governed by cynical people. Our political parties are kind of a joke in the sense that they're so close together. The amount of daylight between, when you think of the broad spectrum of ideology that's out there in the world, the difference between Obama and John Boehner is just not that huge. Living in South Africa for me was a revelation because it's a place where people use words like solidarity without irony, where people really believe in a deep commitment to debating ideas about how humanity should live, where they haven't abdicated completely to the notion that the market reigns supreme, where deep conversations happen about whether being exposed to that range of thought and that openness and willingness to debate how humanity should live go and visit and keep your ears open. And finally, what do I mean?
Well, one thing I want to answer. We don't have a strong opposition party. The opposition parties are very weak, and the ruling party is very strong. Which means that we have a situation where the ruling party can do anything it likes, within, of course, the ambit of constitution. But because of the strength of the civil society, it is restrained. It has no theory.
Yes.
We live in a country, for instance, whereby the same people who are voting yes
today,
when something happens, they are the very people who are out there in the streets, demonstrating against the very government that they elected, even though they are members of the ruling party. Something that you did not see in the rest of Africa. Where the political leaders were defined. And then, of course, a company said, and then they could do anything they wanted. And that's where we ended up with the institutions. The strength of the civil society in general, I think, is one of the biggest goals in our focus on the country, the maintenance of the constitution.
And what's it wonderful just to put a period on that is that at the end of apartheid is not long. Most of the Americans and Western people who contributed to the end of apartheid, once it was over, they said, okay, it's all done, and they went home and they took their money, and civil society pretty much went kaput. But today, even without the money of the international community, which they still need, by the way, but they are growing in strength, and I totally agree with you, Zakes, that civil society is almost like the fourth branch of government. I mean, they really do want to keep the country honest. And I am happy to hear each of you and share your experiences. And just have my own experiences with my husband in South Africa. And I think we all hope that this young democracy will grow. See a greater power keep as time goes on.